Recorded Books presents Bone Rattle by Marc Cameron. Narrated by David Chandler. To my brothers and sisters of the United States Marshal Service, America's Star. Prologue. Alaska. A single bone, or even a bone shard, wouldn't just slow work down, it would stop everything. Dead. The snort and belch of the backhoe rattling along the mountain made Merkuliev feel less isolated than he actually was. There were 37 men working at this mine, including the guy driving the backhoe and the laborer leaning on a shovel next to Merkuliev. That was way too many witnesses for anything sketchy to happen, other than having to endure a few elbows and junior high-level taunts in the chow trailer. They wouldn't have hired him if they didn't want him around, would they? Merkuliev turned up the volume on his phone, letting No One Knows by Queens of the Stone Age pour through his earbuds. He tried to forget about the hatred, reminded himself that he could be working in an office, and kept his eyes peeled for bones. Remote didn't begin to describe the Valkyrie mine. He wasn't just at the end of some dirt road or at the top of a mountain. Roughly 30 miles south of Juneau by boat, the excavation project leading to the mine adit known as Valkyrie No. 3 cut along the side of the mossy green mountain, tucked deep in a glacial valley inside Port Snettisham, a T-shaped inlet of pristine waters off Stevens Passage. Everything here looked near vertical to Merkuliev, or at the very least, too steep for a road. But there had been a road, once upon a time, back in the glory days after Auk Chief Cowie guided Joe Juneau and Richard Harris to gold at Quartz Gulch. Avalanche chutes had washed a good portion of it away. Berry bushes bristled between the remaining timbers hidden beneath the muck. The narrow ledge was rarely much wider than the backhoe tracks at any point, and much of that had been sheared off by heavy snow. Persistent rain turned the rock and freshly dug earth into soup, forcing the native archaeologist and the skinny laborer slouching next to him to be constantly on the move or risk sliding down the hillside into the raging creek that rushed along the valley floor. The mountain on the far side of the narrow valley rose steeply, absent the ugly excavation scar. Snowfields still perched higher up, shielded from the rays of the sun by the perpetual shadows of steep angles. Towering cedar and spruce, jagged boulders, it all felt close enough to touch. Rain pattered on the hood of Merkuliev's Helly Hansen jacket. He would have heard the pop, pop, pop of the droplets, but for Queens of the Stone Age blaring in his earbuds. A steady wind blew down from the ice fields above, making the raindrops sting his face if he looked in the wrong direction. Alaskans knew that cotton killed in the cold and damp. Merkuliev preferred layered wool and a waterproof rain suit. Southeast weather scoffed at water-resistant. An oilcloth ball cap and tall rubber extra-tough boots, often called Juneau sneakers, kept him relatively dry during the long hours he spent standing over the dig. The big 953 Caterpillar track crawler belched and clanked, working steadily along the mountain. Its massive steel bucket swung back and forth overhead, chewing steadily through blueberry brush, moss, and a layer of deep brown earth. Almost black with age and tannin from the surrounding vegetation, a series of logs were arranged side by side on the ground, close together, like the walls of an old fort that had fallen over. It was sad, in a way, to see the old corduroy road torn up. A piece of history gone. But it was not a piece of that history Merkulieff was paid to care about. He breathed in the chilly, ionized scent of wet dirt and decaying wood. The rough-cut logs had been laid down over a century before during the heyday of gold mining in the region. They formed a road to keep the wagons and ore carts out of the ever-present muck. Had there been no old road, the bosses would never have gotten the permits to build a new one. The Tongass National Forest was designated roadless. Period. Fortunately for old man Grimson, the Valkyrie's owner, he'd located this easement to the old mine at it. That meant he wasn't building a new road. He was merely improving one that had been constructed in 1904 to carry ore out of the mine a half mile farther up the valley. Those miners had tunneled in 200 yards and quit, not knowing they were a scant 11 feet from a rich vein of gold-bearing quartz. Harold Grimson had found it, and now he wanted to punch a hole through to the vein. But first, he had to rebuild the road. Core samples projected an ounce of gold for every 6 barrels of ore they hauled out of the mountain. In the mining world, that was a whole lot of gold. They were almost there. It had been the natural place to build a road in the early 1900s, when few cared about rolling roughshod over sacred native sites. Unfortunately for Valkyrie No. 3, these last 300 yards folded back and forth in a series of cliffs and crags, the perfect spot for a burial ground. The 28-year-old archaeologist focused on bones and his music when he should have been worried about the heavy backhoe bucket swinging back and forth on the boom over his head. Dean Schimmel, a laborer in tattered frog togs rain gear that looked like he'd found them wadded up in the trunk of an abandoned car, perched on a crumbling hummock of mossy earth a few feet up the valley. As ever, he leaned on a shovel, looking as spindly as the shovel's handle and extremely glum. He was supposed to act as safety, to keep an eye on Merkulieff, make sure he didn't get himself brained by the swinging backhoe bucket. But Dean Schimmel was just as likely to stare at a passing raven or puff on his cigarette and watch a shuffling porcupine. He was probably a decent enough guy, though he put far too much stock in what Dallas Childers had to say. That guy was bad news. Merkulieff could feel it. Childers, the scowling dude behind the controls of the bright yellow beast, was supposed to stay to the existing road. Instead, he used it as a vague guideline, taking bites of moist earth and rock the size of Lazy Boy recliners out of the mountain at every other turn. Merkulieff didn't try to stop him. Violations of U.S. Forest Service regulations weren't his problem, unless they involved old bones or native settlements. The mine had a strict no-gun policy, but Childers said he'd seen a brown bear a couple of weeks back, so the foreman let him carry a big Glock on a chest rig over his Carhartt overalls. He practiced with it, too, every day out on the old tailings by the ocean. He used oil cans for targets and always made sure someone else was watching so they could see how good he was. He was fast, which was part of being good, Merkulieff thought. There were no more bear sightings, but Childers just kept right on carrying his Glock. No one ever told him not to. Had it been anybody else, Merkulieff might have felt safer, but when he thought it over, he was a lot more concerned about Childers and his Glock than any brown bear. The bulk of the crew was working down at the main operation through the thick forest, a quarter of a mile away, most of them deep underground. It would be all too easy for Childers to murder him and bury him with a backhoe. Forget finding any bones. Childers just flat hated Indians. A mixture of Tlingit, Portuguese and Russian, Isaac Merkuliev had grown up in Petersburg, 160 miles to the south. He knew how to dress for southeast Alaska weather, mist, rain, fog, snow, wind, or any combination thereof. Extra layers could be shed on the rare but spectacularly beautiful sunny days, but cold and wet was always just around the corner waiting to slap you in the face. Merkuliev didn't mind. The endless rain kept everything in unimaginable green. The archaeologist pulled the collar of the fleece jacket inside his raincoat tighter around his neck, eyes moving from the teeth of the heavy bucket to Dallas Childer's sheep-killing dog look. It was in Merkuliev's nature to try to say something friendly, a joke, to cut the tension. But the backhoe's engine isolated the three men and left them each cloistered away in their own world, free to despise or pity the other. Merkuliev had just looked away, resting his eyes for a moment from the monotonous back-and-forth movement of the backhoe's boom, when he heard the tell-tale rattle of the diesel engine revving a little more than usual. Childers had uncovered something and was attempting to swing the bucket back over the top of it. It was too late. Merkuliev leaped forward, scrambling in the soupy dirt, nearly falling in front of the backhoe. He shouted, frantically waving his arms for Childers to stop. A strong hand grabbed the collar of his raincoat and yanked him backward. He heard spewed curses, muffled but angry, as Schimmel dragged him away. Childers killed the engine, letting the silence creep in to join the raging hiss of the river below. Everyone at the mine knew he'd been a sniper in the Marine Corps. Isaac thought he still looked at everyone like he was seeing them through the crosshairs of a scope. He slumped in his seat without leaving the cab for almost half a minute, eyes locked forward as if he was trying to figure out his next move. Isaac hardly noticed the man's gloom. The miners might not be happy, but this was a real find. He could tell that at first glance. The backhoe had stripped away a large table of stone above the ledge, exposing long, cream-colored leg bones, human leg bones. The remaining earth had fallen free quickly as the bucket had swung sideways, revealing most of an entire skeleton situated on a decaying wooden frame. Protected for decades by rock and thick vegetation, the grave was now suddenly exposed to wind and rain. Isaac found himself giddy by the time he climbed down in the roadbed and leaned in to get a better look. Three copper bracelets encircled the wrist bones of the left arm. The remnants of a leather apron lay across the skeleton's lap, adorned with deer hooves and bits of shell. A rattle about the size of a drinking gourd lay next to the tiny bones that had once been the dead person's hand, as if he or she had been holding it at the time of burial. It looked to be made of bone and boiled horn, like nothing Merkuliev had ever seen. Schimmel moved into the dig shoulder to shoulder with Merkuliev, shovel still clutched in his hand. He backpedaled when he saw the skull, mumbling a hasty prayer. Merkuliev would have laughed had he not been so excited. Schimmel was always talking about haunted mines and Tommy knockers, the ghosts of dead miners who tapped on the adit walls. Childers remained behind the controls of the backhoe, slouching, talking on his radio. Merkuliev threw back the hood of his raincoat and squatted down to get a closer look at the gravesite without touching anything. Deerhoof apron, bracelets, raven rattle. I bet you this was a shaman.
Like a witch doctor? Schimmel whispered.
Probably more like the guy who hunted witches, Merkuliev said.
A witch hunter? Schimmel stammered. That would be a good guy, right?
I'd say so. Schimmel's slack-jawed gaze was glued to the bones.
No shit. The Indians around here really had witches and witch hunters?
The oral traditions say so, Merkuliev said.
The way I understand it, the people who lived here believed witches wielded a force that made people sick. Shamans like this guy would have figured out who was the witch and then healed the sick person.
There's witches in the Bible,
Schimmel muttered, always trying to remain relevant.
Did you know that?
I did, Merkuliev said, giving this goofy dude a side eye, then leaning forward to take a photo of the rattle with his phone. Merkuliev could hear Dallas Childers talking on the radio but couldn't make out the words over the sound of the river. The bosses had to be pissed. They were probably trying to figure out a way around this. There wasn't one. This find was beyond incredible. This rattle is different, Merkuliev said, grabbing a jutting stone in the muck to support himself so he could lean in and get a closer look. The rattle was roughly a foot long and 5 or 6 inches at its widest point. The image of a human figure in a raven mask was faintly visible on the horn body. All the rattles I've seen have been carved from cedar or other kinds of wood and newer, otherwise they'd have rotted away. This one looks to be very old. I think it's made of doll sheep horn, boiled so they could form it. Schimmel grunted.
So?
Doll sheep were sacred to the Tlingit, Merkuliev said. Lots of taboos surrounded their hunting. He put a hand on Schimmel's shoulder, squeezing him in excitement. I've got so much work to do, so many questions. I'm not even sure they had doll sheep in this area at the time this was made. This grave could help identify ancient trade routes between coastal and inland peoples.
Is it worth anything?
The rattle? Schimmel nodded, chin on his hands, hands on his shovel.
Yeah.
I'd say it is, Merkuliev said, hovering over the bones like a mother bird protecting her nest. A wooden raven rattle about this same size sold for over $500,000 last year. Schimmel stood up now.
$500,000?
Yep. Merkuliev stood. He was unwilling to molest the site any more. He had Tlingit blood in his veins, but not the cultural expertise to know what needed to be done to take care of the site. I need to make a call. Childers was still busy on the radio, but he looked up to listen to what Merkuliev was saying now. Sorry to stop you guys, the archaeologist said. We need to get someone in here who can tell us if special ceremonies are needed.
What do you mean, ceremonies?
Schimmel asked. Merkuliev gave an emphatic nod. If I'm right, and these bones belong to an actual Tlingit shaman, there will need to be some prayers, that sort of thing. Childers relayed everything over the radio, stopping short when Merkuliev said, We may have to reroute the road. Childers lowered the radio a hair and glared. We can't reroute the road. Merkuliev, enthralled in his new find, failed to notice the darker mood shift. Instead, he babbled on. True, I suppose. Tlingit customarily buried their shaman in out-of-the-way places, but there is a lot we don't know. There could be other burial sites all around here. I don't know how much land is considered sacred around a shaman's tomb. These are questions for a cultural expert, not me. They'd have to make that call. Childers raised the radio to his lips again, listened for a while, and then held up a hand.
Mr. Dollarhide agrees.
Wait, Mr. Dollarhide is here? Merkuliev had expected to deal with Eau Claire, the mine foreman, not Harold Grimson's creepy fixer and right-hand man. Childers gave a smug nod. He was more relaxed now that his de facto boss was on the scene.
He says to tell you, good catch. This is a hell of a find, he says.
He's not mad?
No,
Childers said, stone-faced. It was almost like he was reading from a script.
According to Mr. Dollarhide, your bones could put Valkyrie Mine on the map. Might even help with public relations for all our other projects. He wants you to grab a few photos and then he'll take you back into Juneau in the fast boat.
This was certainly not the way Merkuliev thought it would play out.
No, he said. I should stay with the dig.
Childers lowered his eyes, peering down from the seat of his backhoe.
You want me to get on the radio and tell Mr. Dollarhide you said no? See how that works out for you. Personally, he says I'm going in the fast boat back to Juneau. I'm getting my ass in the fast boat back to Juneau. Sounds like he wants to do a press release with you about your discovery.
Merkuliev took a half step back, shaking his head. It's a little early for a press.
He's the boss, Schimmel grunted.
No, Dollarhide works for the boss, Merkuliev said.
So that makes him our boss, Childers said.
A man wearing dark green rain gear came around the trees on a growling four-wheeler below. Eau Claire, the grizzled mine foreman, bounced up the rough roadbed, dodging rocks the size of basketballs. The rain was beginning to pick up, and Merkuliev was relieved to see that he'd brought some tarps.
Dollarhide said bring these.
The foreman habitually blurted out everything he wanted to say at once, like he didn't want to spend the effort to space his words.
Cover the site. Keep it dry.
Merkuliev exhaled sharply through his mouth, tension leaving on the cloud of vapor. Maybe the boss was on board with this. Dean Schimmel wasn't against work, so long as the bulk of that work meant he was leaning on his shovel and watching other people. Childers was pissed, he could tell. And that always made him a little nervous. It took 15 minutes for the four men to help construct a makeshift tent over the shaman's grave using tarps and heavy rocks. The fool archaeologist ran his mouth the entire time, like he'd just found the crystal skull or some shit and not a bunch of dried-up bones. All of them were soaked and covered with mud by the time they got the rain directed away from the gravesite. Finally, Eau Claire put the babbling archaeologist on the back of his four-wheeler and carried him down to Dollarhide and the waiting fast boat. Childers and Schimmel stood in the ankle-deep mud, hoods pulled up around their faces for a while and smoked. Childers didn't feel like talking to Schimmel, and Schimmel never knew what to say unless someone else started the conversation. So they stared at the hole they'd dug and listened to the stream rush down from the glaciers. 10 minutes after he finished his second cigarette, Dallas Childers threw back the hood of his raincoat. He grabbed the bar on the side of his backhoe and hauled himself into the cab with a grunt. Schimmel, still leaning with both hands on the shovel handle, looked up, trying to make sense of what was going on.
What are you doing?
We got a road to build,
Childers said. Settling into his seat, he snatched up a thermos and unscrewed the top to get a warm-up from the coffee and the other Kentucky goodness he had mixed in there.
What about the bones?
What bones? Childers said. I don't see any bones.
And the archaeologist?
Childers chuckled at that.
What archaeologist? Eau Claire is taking him to the South Dock to meet Mr. Dollarhide. Nobody's gonna see him get on that boat.
Schimmel gave a slow nod as the understanding crept in like a tickle on his brain. Mr. Dollarhide would shoot Merkuliev, or maybe hit him with a rock. You could never tell with that guy. He might even tie an anchor around the kid's feet and dump him over alive. That dude was always licking his lips and smiling that sadistic smile. Schimmel didn't want to know the details. Not knowing meant he could tell himself he wasn't a witness to a murder. He wouldn't have minded killing the dumbass kid himself, but witnessing a killing made you a loose end, and Schimmel sure as hell didn't want to be a loose end with lip-licking Dollarhide sneaking around tying things up for Mr. Grimson. Schimmel stepped back as the backhoe's diesel engine rattled to life. This shit was about to get real. It was better to stay in the dark about the details.
Get your ass out of that dig, Childers yelled.
He bent over to fiddle with his backhoe controls. Schimmel stooped quickly and lifted the edge of the tarp, scooping up the bone rattle while Childers was busy and shoving it in the pocket of his frog togs. He glanced sideways, holding his breath, bracing himself for the shitstorm that would fall on him if Childers saw him try to walk off with evidence that the burial site existed. Tension always made him feel like he had to pee. Childers sat up straight in his seat again.
I told you to get out of the dig.
No mention of the rattle. Childers was so deaf from the rumble of diesel engines and gunfire over the years that Schimmel was sure he hadn't heard a thing the archaeologist kid had said about how much the bone rattle was worth. Schimmel scrambled out of the roadbed, dragging the blue tarps with him so there would be no trace when Childers put the skeleton and creepy deerhoof apron back where it belonged, deep in the dirt. His hand dropped into the pocket of his raincoat, fingers wrapping around the handle of the bone rattle. It felt exceptionally heavy, especially with Childers frowning down at him with the big gun strapped across his chest. $500,000 was a lot of money. Worth the risk, Schimmel told himself. Still, you couldn't spend a dollar if you were dead. He could sell it at a discount to someone who knew how much it was worth. But he didn't know anyone who had more than a couple $100 besides Mr. Grimson or Mr. Dollarhide, and he sure as hell wasn't telling them. No, he'd have to figure something out. But he had time. He wondered if the rattle might be cursed. It could be. There were curses in the Bible, bad ones, and witches too. Maybe. He wasn't really sure about the witches. Schimmel lit another cigarette and ran a finger along the bumps and ridges of the carved horn inside his pocket. Maybe Isaac Merkulieff had eaten all the bone rattle's bad luck. Knowing Mr. Dollarhide, the kid was already taking a saltwater snooze by now. He adjusted his earmuffs and then leaned on his shovel to formulate a plan. If everything worked out just right, he'd make some good money, and it probably wouldn't get him killed. Only the drones are left. The warriors have gone to work. Cook Island Maori Proverb. Day 1. Chapter 1. Anchorage. Supervisory Deputy U.S. Marshal Arliss Cutter's grandfather had warned him early on, if they're cornered, just about anybody on Earth would jam a pencil into your eye. That was Cutter's job, cornering people. On paper, Jerome Pringle was just number 3 on a list of wanted criminals the Alaska Fugitive Task Force had focused on for the week. Nothing special, not dangerous, but then Jerome Pringle had never been cornered. Cutter took his grandfather's teachings to heart and passed them on to the deputies he trained, the deputies he kicked doors with, like today. Whenever possible, Cutter liked to hunt his fugitives in the tiny sliver of time when dogs and dopers overlapped their sleeps. It was the safest, if not the most convenient time to hit a house for a fugitive. It lowered the odds that anyone on his team would get a pencil in the eye. It was still dark, but that rarely helped you tell time in Alaska. In this case, it was early, a little after 5 a.m. It was still cold enough for a coat, but getting warmer every day, warm enough that the gray mountains of snow, 15, 20 feet high, that had been piled up in virtually every Anchorage parking lot and neighborhood cul-de-sac, would weep rivulets of dirty water into the streets as soon as the sun came up in a couple of hours. With any luck, the task force would be done by then and making ops plans for the next fugitive. Fugitive work, often simply called enforcement, was the sexy side of the Marshal's service. Everybody had to hook and haul prisoners at some point in his or her career. Deputy U.S. Marshals, DUSMs, sat in court and listened to attorneys drone on for so long they probably could pass the bar. They took mugshots, rolled fingerprints, conducted strip searches, lift and turn please, met the airlift with van loads of bad guys, but nobody came aboard for all that. You got a job with the Marshals Service because you wanted to work enforcement. You wanted to hunt. A good chief deputy spread the wealth. Jill Phillips was one of the best. She made sure every POD, plain old deputy in the District of Alaska, even the ones who'd just graduated from Marshall's Basic at the Federal Law Enforcement Training Center, had a warrant or two of their own to work. PODs divided their time between court, judicial protection, asset forfeiture, hurricane aftermath, guarding dignitaries with state at the United Nations General Assembly, pretty much anything the Attorney General decided he or she wanted the Marshal's Service to do. Deputies assigned to the Alaska Fugitive Task Force rarely had to dilute their schedule with collateral duties. They hunted every day and many nights. They cornered the name on the paper, took him or her to jail, and then moved on to the next warrant in the stack, all the while trying not to get shot or stabbed by some bad guy's baby mama. Cutter mulled over his grandfather's wisdom as he drove through the back streets of midtown Anchorage in the gunmetal chill of the pre-dawn darkness. Gravel popped under the tires of his government-issue SUV. It was a Ford Escape, surely a joke from USMS Fleet Management in D.C. His partner, Deputy Lola Teariki, a Polynesian of Cook Island Maori descent, sat in the passenger seat. She was not a particularly large woman, but her personality sprawled across the inside of the vehicle and took up a lot of space. Still a ways from 30, she had 4 years on with the service. Thick ebony hair piled high on her head in a tight bun, still glistening from the shower after her zero dark 30 workout. She and Cutter were dressed alike. Navy blue long-sleeve shirts, khaki vertex pants, and olive drab load-bearing ballistic vests with a five-pointed circular star badge and police U.S. Marshal embroidered in white across the back. Gazing out the passenger window, she brooded over something. She'd speak up soon. She always did. Even half-formed ideas seemed too much of a burden for Lola to carry around. She had to get them off her chest. That usually meant telling it all to Cutter, letting him in on what she'd figured out with the certitude that came from her two-point-something decades on the planet. He didn't mind. She was a good kid. A little blabby, but her heart was in the right place, and she'd sure proved herself. Fit, smart, and hit on by pretty much every male officer or agent who met her, she was tough as an old boot, ready to jump in and go to town when more fragile souls might shy away. She could bat her lashes innocently one minute, then intimidate the hell out of some bad guy when she rolled her eyes and scrunched her nose the next. She called it going Polynesian princess to Maori warrior face. For now, whatever notion that was taking shape inside her head was still in its early stages, so she was quiet, allowing Cutter to ponder on his grandfather while he drove the last two blocks to the meeting. For as long as Arliss had known him, the old man, called Grumpy by most, lived by a certain creed. He called these doctrines his grumpy man rules and passed them on to the grandsons he'd raised. Arliss's brother Ethan had gone on to become an engineer, a noble profession to be sure, but a mystery to Grumpy. The old man had been an officer with Florida Marine Patrol. He chased poachers, rescued idiots, patrolled in his airboat to enforce the law on the water, and there was a lot of water in Florida. Arliss had followed, but on the federal side of the business, which riled the old man at first. Still, Grumpy saved back a few of his axioms that had special meaning to someone who carried a badge, even if it was for the feds, who he generally felt were as useless as tits on a boar hog. Well over a decade in the U.S. Marshals, not to mention Cutter's time with the 75th Rangers, had borne out the old man's wisdom in spades. Cutter made a left. Lola kept quiet, still forming her notion. Jerome Pringle's warrant file said he was harmless, but Cutter knew better. There was no such thing as harmless, not in this line of work. Cutter mulled over the possible outcomes, letting the chilly wind through his open window hit him in the face, bracing him awake. Spring in Alaska wasn't all kite flying and daffodils. Breakup, they called it, as in the ice on the rivers was breaking up. Breakup in the city meant mud and dust and more mud. He found himself glad the temps had dropped into the high 20s overnight, frosting the glass and freezing the mud while they worked this warrant. Some sourdoughs joked there were only two seasons, winter and July. A native of Florida and lover of all things to do with the sea and beach, Cutter found the great land pleasant, mostly. He loved the fall, enjoyed the summers, found new things to learn in the austerity and bitter winters of the interior. But breakup? There wasn't much to like about slop and slush and windshields that you could never get clean. The light was good, though. By mid-May, the sun would rise in Utqiagvik, or Barrow, and wouldn't dip below the horizon again for 84 days. Anchorage wasn't as drastic. Here they gained something like 5 minutes a day until they had about 20 hours of light. Cutter was the supervisory deputy over enforcement in Alaska, which meant he ran the task force. He chose which paper the teams worked, approved the operational plans, and kicked the biggest ones up to the chief for her check before anyone kicked a door. Safety for all members of the task force fell to him. It didn't matter if they were deputies like Lola Teoriki, officers detailed from Anchorage Police Department, Alaska State Troopers, or other feds from DHS or ATF. Cutter led from the front, which often meant getting out of the way and letting his guys do their job. Another thing Grumpy had taught him. A thick head of perpetually mussed blonde hair put Cutter at little over 6'3". He steered clear of weights for the most part, staying in shape with running, push-ups, pull-ups, and swimming, plus a little work on the heavy bag every couple of days. With a fighting weight of 2 1/4, he was only just able to wedge himself behind the wheel of the mid-sized Ford SUV when he wore all his tactical gear. In his early 40s, Cutter had yet to hit the metabolic wall that caused so many of his peers to turn into deputy donuts instead of the lean machines they'd been out of Marshall's Service Basic. He was lucky in that regard. The rest of his life? "We need a new name, Cutter," Lola said, shattering the silence. The weight of her idea had grown too heavy for her to bear alone. Her father's Kiwi accent sharpened Teoriki's vowels and chased away her R's when she was tired, turning Cutter into Cutta. They were too close to the meeting point to get into a long conversation, which is why he humored her. "A new name for what?" Lola yawned, big like a lioness. "For the Alaska Fugitive Task Force. AFTF is stuffed as far as acronyms go. It doesn't mean anything." "It's too early for this, Lola," Cutter said, driving over a bump of old snow as he took a corner.
"Hear me out, boss," Teoriki patted the console between them. "A good acronym says something about what it stands for. Like the fist operations the Marshal Service used to do back in the day.
Fugitive Investigative Strike Team. Now that's got verve.
Cutter shrugged. How about the Falcon roundups? Lola scoffed, making a buzzer sound.
Lame. Federal and local cops, I don't even remember. On night shift? No.
Also stuffed. The acronym should at least make sense.
She folded her arms over the front of her ballistic vest and stared out the windshield at the darkness.
I'll keep thinking on it.
You do that, Cutter said, making another turn down a dark street toward the rally point, where his team would link up with two uniformed Anchorage police officers. The smell of new birch and cottonwood buds on the cold air pinched his nose as he drove. There were other odors, too, coming through the open window, less pleasant. Anchorage was a city of over 60,000 dogs, which was all well and good, Cutter-like dogs. But not every owner was responsible, and that many pups left behind a lot of little melting landmines as the snows receded. Another reason not to like breakup. One of those 60,000 dogs woofed somewhere down the block, grumbling at the chill. Another SUV was already parked along the road ahead, along with two marked APD cruisers. Cutter pulled in behind the SUV, two blocks east of Jerome Pringle's residence. It was time to not get stabbed in the eye.
Chapter 2.
Apart from being a tall, fat, white guy who spoke with a distinctive Jamaican patois, Jerome Pringle seemed an unremarkable fugitive. The task force had dealt with him before. He'd been no problem, but in that instance, they'd snatched him out of a vehicle on a traffic stop. This time, they were going into his house, or more accurately, his new girlfriend's house. Cutter had chosen the edge of this vacant lot for a quick briefing. It was near an Anchorage greenbelt of birch and spruce trees that ran along Chester Creek, but far enough away that no one at Pringle's could hear vehicle doors shutting in the pre-dawn darkness. Cutter killed the headlights and reached between the center console and his seat for his battle board. The dome light remained off when he opened the door. Anything else was a recipe for getting shot. Lola arched her back, stretching, hands pressed flat on the Ford's headliner in another long feline yawn.
You got the warrant file?
Got it, Cutter said. He held up the multicam battle board, essentially a ballistic nylon folder with a clear plexiglass face, under which he'd slipped a map of the neighborhood and a hand-sketched floor plan of the house. He'd marked up the map and floor plan with a grease pencil to aid in the briefing he was about to give the two Anchorage police officers, who were there to help with the early morning arrest. He'd gone over everything with Lola and the other two participating members of the task force the evening before. The DEA had arrested Pringle for possession of heroin the month before. They had some intel that he was trying to establish a foothold for a Jamaican posse in Anchorage, but he'd been holding only a couple of grams at the time, not enough to prove intent to sell. His defense attorney had convinced the judge that he was only holding the drugs for his troubled girlfriend. Merely a good man, doing the right thing to help curb the terrible opiate epidemic. The magistrate hadn't exactly believed that theory, but was troubled by the small amount of heroin if Pringle was supposed to be such a player, and allowed him out on bond. He'd promptly gotten arrested again for the DUI. The state judge allowed him out on his own recognizance as soon as he was sober enough to stagger, but the incident had triggered a federal supervised release violation. Pringle was no rocket scientist, but he was probably bright enough to realize an arrest warrant was trickling down to some guys somewhere with guns and badges. Cutter wanted at least a couple of those badges and guns to be APD. The uniforms gave clarity in these hazy morning hours.
Sean Blodgett, a stocky stub of a deputy with a map of scars visible through his buzz cut, sauntered up beside Cutter. He took another quick look at the battle board on the hood of the SUV and gave a knowing nod. A bit of a shit magnet, Blodgett couldn't seem to get out of his own way. He ended up with some sort of sprain, scrape, or contusion at least once a month. Still, he was tough as a bull, spending nearly as much time in the gym as Lola. Other deputies in the office had taken to calling him BAF, for big-armed Fed. But Cutter had always thought he looked a little like a T-Rex with his arms sticking out of the oversized ballistic vest. Nancy Alvarez, Blodgett's partner on the task force, wore the same vest, but she wore it better, more naturally. A hell of a manhunter, she was on loan from Anchorage PD, and often acted as liaison, smoothing the way for Cutter when they needed to steal a couple of uniforms to hit a house but didn't want to call in SWAT. The responding officers, a black female named Brooks and a tall kid named Slavich, who looked like he should have been playing for the NBA, gravitated toward Alvarez. She carried Special Deputy U.S. Marshal credentials, but at heart, she was one of them. Cutter opened the battle board and took out four copies of Pringle's last booking photo. A cold wind rattled out of the birch forest to the northwest, making him thankful for the vest and long-sleeve shirt. He'd have been scuba diving this time of year if he were back in Florida. Cutter went over the layout of the house and the suspected occupants. Should be just him and his girlfriend. No kids that we're aware of. This Pringle guy a fighter? Officer Brooks asked. She studied the booking photo under the glare of the streetlight, making a couple of notes in a little pad. Not exactly, Cutter said, forcing a half smile for the sake of the two officers. He'd inherited his grandfather's tendency toward a mean mug, but he didn't want all the young troops on patrol thinking the boss of the fugitive task force walked around looking pissed off at the world. He tapped his copy of the photo with his index finger. Pringle was a heavy man, well over 300 pounds, with a fountain of dreadlocks sprouting off a head that looked the size of a basketball. He's what my granddad would have called a butter bean, like a regular bean, only bigger. He's got more mass than meanness, but that much mass can hurt you even if he's just trying to get away. We popped him last year at his baby mama's house, Lola said. He tried to hide his fat ass under a pile of dirty clothes. He had a pet tarantula, though, or at least he did. Kind of freaked me out, to be honest.
Kill it with fire, Blodgett observed, sounding and looking dead serious.
Cutter put a hand flat on the hood of his SUV, the movement pulling everyone's attention toward him in the scant light. It goes without saying, but spiders do not constitute a deadly force scenario, not even big hairy ones. Still, Alvarez said, don't hesitate to tase the SOB if he doesn't comply with your orders. And for Pete's sake, don't stop in front of him once he starts moving.
Copy, both officers said at once.
Small favor, Cutter said, addressing the two uniforms. Deputy Blodgett is covering the rear of the residence. Would one of you mind helping him out? Slavich scratched the top of his head and yawned. It was nearing the end of his 10-hour shift.
I'll go.
Outstanding. Cutter nodded at Alvarez, who was to explain the tactics. Nancy?
We'll try not to kick the door, she said. Pringle's girlfriend is good for dozens of vehicle burglaries, and thieves are paranoid as hell about anybody stealing the stuff that they stole from someone else. The Silverado parked out front looks to have a working alarm. I'll try to get in it, set it off. She'll come to the door to see who's trying to take her shit.
She outlined the rest of her plan, rocking back and forth to keep her feet warm. Okay, Cutter said, knowing how quickly briefings could devolve. Last condo on the end of four, dirty white siding with black trim.
He jabbed at the map again to get it set in everyone's mind.
Wooden planter on the right side of the porch.
much like the timeout that surgeons did before an operation to make sure they were cutting the right bits off the right patient. Cutter liked to remind everyone of the physical location of their target one last time before they moved. Booting the wrong door could prove every bit as dire as taking the wrong kidney. "Weapons?" Officer Brooks asked. She was bright-eyed, fit, smaller than Lola, with hardly enough room on her waist for her Glock, extra magazines, taser, pepper spray, radio, and handcuffs. "There was a handgun in the drawer during the last arrest," Lola said. "It was stolen, so we took that one, but I'd assume he's replaced it, if only to keep from getting robbed by other heroin dealers." Brooks nodded slowly, as if she expected as much. Sean Blodgett's face screwed into an angry grimace. "And maybe a spider," he said. Chapter 3 Cutter tapped the Colt Python revolver at his side, his grandfather's service weapon. The USMS regulation Glock rested over his right kidney. He moved quickly down the street with Lola and Officer Brooks on his heels. They stopped in a line at the edge of the driveway, 15 feet from the front door, using the shadows of a fat blue spruce for concealment. Cutter took a deep breath of the chilly air, centering his thoughts. There was a certain smell to working a warrant, brighter, more alive. Grumpy always said if you didn't smell it, you were in the wrong business. Cutter had been creeping up on bad guys for nearly 20 years if he counted his military time. Mud hut, remote cabin, or residential neighborhood, it never got old. Pistols out and stacked single file. They were close enough to hear one another breathing. Officer Brooks, who brought up the rear, gave Lola a firm tap on the side of the thigh with her non-dominant hand. She was good to go. Lola repeated the gesture to Cutter, who did the same to Alvarez, who trotted off without another word. From this point on, things would unfold at lightning speed. Officer Brooks and Lola peeled off the line as soon as Alvarez reached the car, padding softly up the concrete steps to take up positions on the porch on either side of the door jamb, out of the fatal funnel. Cutter covered Nancy, watching the windows above while she approached the truck. Another dog barked, this one closer. Each tiny noise sounded exponentially louder than it really was. The zip of spruce boughs against a ballistic nylon vest surely woke everyone in the neighborhood. Lola's stifled cough echoed all the way down the street. It was getting light enough to see Alvarez clearly as she lifted the door handle on Pringle's blue Silverado, using the body of the vehicle for cover. She put her hip into the truck, rocking it. Headlights flashed and the horn blared. That part of her mission complete, Alvarez trotted up the steps and parked herself behind Lola. Now Cutter could move. He reached the porch in four quick strides, skipping all but one step to fall in behind the others at the same moment the door yawned open. Pringle's girlfriend stepped out wearing nothing but a terry cloth robe and a very large pair of panties. She was a corpulent woman, and the robe, meant for someone much smaller, did little to hide everything that wasn't covered by the undies. One hand shielding her eyes from the flashing headlights, the other held a cell phone. As Alvarez had pointed out, it was astounding how quickly felons called in help when someone tried to steal what they'd stolen from someone else. Officer Brooks identified herself and motioned the woman the rest of the way out with a flick of her hand. Lola and Alvarez covered the open door with their handguns. Cutter bumped Lola so she could take a step inside and cover the entry. The stairway to the second floor was 8 feet across the small foyer. Back to the door, Cutter took note of the coat closet to his right. There was always a closet, and the open hall leading to the rear of the house. He covered the landing above with his Colt, while Alvarez covered the interior hall.
The heat inside the house was turned up full blast, and the moldering odor of dirty socks and sour dishes hit them full in the face. It smelled like a felony warrant. Officer Brooks turned the heavy woman so she could cuff her before the shock of seeing cops at the door wore off. The ratchet sound of the handcuffs brought the woman out of her stupor.
"Why are you doing this? Am I under arrest?"
"Depends," Alvarez said, her voice calm but firm.
"You're going to let me tie my robe?"
"Just face the wall and you'll be fine," Alvarez said over her shoulder, standing just inside the door. "Which room is Jerome in?"
"He's not here," the girlfriend said.
"That's a good way to be under arrest," Alvarez said. "We know he's here. If you hide him, you go to jail for hindering."
"Why you ask me that shit if you already know?"
"I asked what room he's in," Alvarez reminded her. The woman gave an insolent shrug.
"I'm freezing my ass off out here on the porch. How am I supposed to know where he is?"
"Got a long gun leaning against the wall at the top of the steps," Lola piped.
"Who else is here?" Brooks asked.
"Just us," the woman said.
Alvarez shook her head.
"Us?" "Me and Jerome."
Cutter pointed to the left, motioning for Lola to come with him and clear the bottom floor while Nancy Alvarez watched the stairway. He didn't like huddling at the door for too long. At that moment, Jerome Pringle stumbled around the corner from the direction of the kitchen. Dreadlocks stuck skyward from a hard night's sleep. Belly rolls all but obscured his leopard print Speedo. He didn't appear to see Cutter until he made it well into the foyer. He tried to spin and run up the stairs, but didn't have the dexterity or speed.
"Jerome!" Cutter barked. "Stop! U.S. Marshals!"
Unwilling to let him get to the gun, Cutter sprang forward, catching Pringle by the hairy shoulder before he made the second step. The big man roared, furious at having his castle invaded so early in the morning. Cutter was not a small man, but Pringle had him by at least 100 pounds and teetering on the stairs above him nearly a foot of height. Prudently, Cutter took a step back, knowing from experience what Lola was about to do. The vast majority of fights Cutter had been in over the course of his law enforcement career hadn't really been fights at all, but someone trying to get away while Cutter attempted to stop them. The trouble was, Pringle was running toward a gun. It was dangerous to deploy a taser on someone on the stairs, but more dangerous still to let them get to a firearm. Cutter saw the red laser dot settle, one between Pringle's hairy shoulder blades, the other in the geographic center of his buttocks.
"Jerome Pring,"
Lola said. He started to run again.
"Tase, tase, tase," Lola barked.
There was an audible snap as the nitrogen canisters popped the plastic gates off the front of the cartridge, propelling twin barbed darts on gossamer wires, angling slightly to give a greater coverage, meaning more muscles for the electrical current to disrupt. The barbs followed the red laser dots. Pringle went rigid, the banister post at the base of the stairs arresting his fall and sending him sideways onto the landing. Onlookers might think Cutter stuck out his boot to give Pringle a kick, but in reality, he was making sure the man's head didn't smack the tile floor as he fell.
"Hands!"
Lola snapped. She was the one holding the taser, so she gave the commands. Pringle moaned. He'd knocked a tooth out on the pillar at the bottom of the stairs, and it lay on the ground beside his face.
"You bitch!"
"More where that came from," Lola said. "Hands behind your back." Teetering on his belly, the outlaw complied, hesitantly lifting his flabby arms so she didn't shock him again. Cutter was closer, so he moved in to apply the handcuffs. Pringle's back was as wide as a barn door, and Cutter had to use 2 linked sets in order to pull both wrists close enough together. A heavy clunk thudded from somewhere on the upper floor at the same moment the radio on Cutter's belt squawked. He ratcheted on the cuffs and drew his Colt. Sean Blodgett's voice poured into the room.
White female and white male looking out the top floor window, boss. Might be Shiloh Watts. Pretty sure the male is Corbin McGrone. Both are 1099.
1099 meant the warrant gods were smiling. Bycatch, or scooping up unintended targets when rounding up a fugitive, was common enough. Like fell in with like, and fugitives running from the law tended to do their running in groups. Another thud came from upstairs, then a woman's scream, long and piercing.
Bronco!
It was a cry of anger, not ecstasy. Lola mouthed the name. Bronco? That's what it sounded like, Cutter said.
Go ahead, Alvarez whispered. I've got this one.
Pringle's body effectively dammed the bottom of the steps, forcing Lola and Cutter both to jump over top of him. Few things compelled Arliss Cutter to run faster than a scream. He forced himself to move methodically but quickly, Colt Python moving in concert with his eyes as he took each step. He brought the second floor into view bit by bit. Lola stayed two steps back, giving herself room to maneuver if things went south. The woman wailed again, long and trailing, desperate. The condo wasn't big, allowing Cutter and Lola to clear the single bathroom and another empty bedroom quickly before slowing outside the room with the screaming woman. It was the only door left, so Corbin McGrone, or someone who looked like him, had to be inside. He glanced at Lola just long enough to make sure they were both on the same sheet of music. A quick nod told him she intended to buttonhook to the right around the door frame while he went left. McGrone was a wiry tweaker who'd run track at Diamond High School. In addition to being fast, he was known to have a propensity to fight that Cutter had read about but never experienced firsthand. There was no good position of cover in a thin-walled condo, so Cutter rolled in without announcing, preferring not to get shot through the sheetrock. He expected to find Watts and McGrone, but instead found a woman he didn't recognize sitting on the edge of a rumpled bed in a pair of gym shorts and a stained white wife-beater shirt. She clutched her greasy red bangs and rocked back and forth, sobbing hysterically. Shiloh Watts was a head taller and had short, bottle blonde hair. Neither she nor Corbin McGrone were anywhere to be found. Hands! Cutter barked as Lola did a quick peek through the open closet doorway. The woman raised her hands but ratcheted up her screaming as soon as she saw the marshals. She spewed saliva with every curse, ordering them out of her room. If she was a victim, she wasn't looking for help from law enforcement. The bedroom was cramped and hot, heaped with dirty laundry and old Chinese takeout boxes. A cloying barnyard stench, 10 times worse than downstairs, hung heavy in the stifling space, made worse by the piercing screams. There were few places to hide. The window was closed, which left under the bed and inside a heavy oak armoire against the wall. A pile of clothing and coat hangers lay on the floor in front of the armoire. One or even both of them had to be in there. It would be tight, but Cutter had seen full-grown men contort themselves to hide under bathroom sinks. Cutter pointed toward the bed while he covered the armoire. He wasn't just clearing a room, he was instilling in Lola the correct way to clear a room. The redhead continued her spit-slinging tirade, glaring at Cutter as if she wanted him to catch fire. Lola kicked a leather boot that was on the floor, sending it sliding under the bed. She stooped at the same moment, getting a quick look. She shook her head. "Where are they?" Cutter asked, still aimed in on the armoire.
"I'm not telling you shit,"
the redhead screeched. "Hey," Lola said, her voice pointed.
"Who's Bronco?" "Get out of my house!"
Cutter reached for the armoire door with his off hand. The redhead sprang from the bed in a rage, rushing to intercept Cutter. She had something in her hand, not a gun, but something a shade larger than her fist. Cutter realized just before the searing pain hit his cheek
that she'd tossed the contents of a clear plastic box at his head. The case held not a tarantula, but a small brown scorpion. It was hardly much larger than a quarter. Most of that must have been made up of stinger, considering the acid-like burning sensation between Cutter's eye and the corner of his mouth. He slapped his own face out of instinct, getting stung in the hand for his trouble. The hapless scorpion fell on the ground, and Cutter's boot ended its short reign of terror. Lola caught the screaming woman by the hair as she ran at Cutter, squatting slightly to lower her center. It had the same effect as clotheslining a runner. The redhead's feet outran her body. Lola held on until just the right moment to let the woman fall flat on her back, knocking the wind out of her sails and mercifully silencing her screams.
"Bronco!"
she croaked, the air escaping a slashed tire. "Stay down," Lola hissed. She sidestepped to cover Cutter. "What was it? I didn't see a spider. Are you okay?" Her head moved as if on a swivel, searching the room while the muzzle of her pistol covered the armoire. Cutter nodded at the crushed scorpion on the floor. "Got me a good one," he said, then flung open the armoire door. Worse than empty, instead of Watts and McGrone, they found a 4-foot hole cut out of the back of the armoire and completely through the wall into the next condo.
"Sneaky bastards," Lola whispered. "They made a habit trail."
Cutter jerked the radio out of his pocket while Lola rolled the redhead onto her belly. She laughed maniacally as Lola zipped a pair of nylon restraints around her wrists. "Watts and McGrone have gone through the wall," he said. "They're in the adjacent condo." Sean Blodgett answered,
"The wall?"
"Affirmative," Cutter said. "Watch the windows. Nancy, if able, you or Brooks keep an eye on the front. The name Bronco ring a bell with anybody?" Blodgett spoke again.
"Billy Gorman. He goes by Bronco. 5'9", 180. Used to fight in the AFC octagon until he started running with McGrone."
"Copy," Cutter said. "Nancy, let's get some more PD folks here and set up a perimeter before we..." The radio bonked, garbling Cutter's message as one of the other units attempted to talk over him. Officer Slavich broke squelch as soon as Cutter released the transmit key. Blodgett could be heard shouting in the background.
"Three just bailed out the back," Slavich said, breathless, moving. "Gorman took out Blodgett's knee, so I'm going after him. McGrone and Watts are running north, about to disappear into the woods."
Officer Brooks appeared at the bedroom door, announcing herself so she didn't get shot. "Stay with her," Cutter said, nodding toward the redhead before starting for the stairs. Lola followed tight on his heels. Almost giddy with the joy of a foot pursuit, she chuckled as they bounded down the stairs. Cold air hit them in the face as they burst out the back door and ran toward the dark line of trees. Chapter 4. Anchorage PD Patrol Officer Joe Bill Brackett's primary field training officer once told him that every cop who stayed on the job for more than a few months would have at least one call that stuck with him. The haunting, he called it. Joe Brackett's haunting came the first day he was by himself on patrol. He was on his own, that is, absent a field training officer critiquing his every move for a grand total of 2 hours. He'd heard Brooks and Slavich dispatched to link up with Nancy Alvarez not far from Chester Creek. That meant the Marshal's task force was hitting a house. Brackett loved working fugitives. He would have killed to help with a call like that. Instead, he got an 1138, a mental subject. Brooks and Slavich got to arrest a wanted felon, while Brackett had to deal with a crazy out on Point Warrensoff. He'd probably have the opportunity to talk to some homeless guy who muttered about how aliens were scanning his brainwaves. Brooks and Slavich might get to boot a door. Lucky bastards.
Brackett glanced down at the open laptop connected to the mobile data terminal in his patrol car. His designator turned red, joining the column of officers who were attached to calls. Officers who were free were in yellow. A long column of green designators indicated day shift, who were at this moment sitting in fallout at the new HQ downtown. It was a few minutes before 7 in the morning, and they would hit the streets shortly, providing overlap staffing with midshift. The sun would be up for real an hour after that. Brackett cracked his passenger window to jolt himself awake. The chilly odor of birch and melting snow was like the ozone smell after a rain, only more biting. He couldn't help but smile. Even an 11:38 was better than his last two jobs, peddling supplements at GNC or loading money into ATMs. He'd wanted to be a cop since he was a little kid, and now here he was, on his own.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.